Good evening, everybody. My name is Mia Karatassis, and I will be your Master of Ceremonies for tonight's event. I am a member of Pontus's Youth Committee, a student in the Senior Dance Group, and I'm currently in my second year of university studying a Bachelor of Health Science at the University of Sydney. We would like to welcome you to our first event as part of the Archdiocese National Committee commemorating 200 years of the Hellenic War of Independence. Our Pontian associations, Pontus New South Wales, Baniya Sumela, New South Wales, Sydney, and the Oyenis Wollongong, along with the Federation of the Pontian Associations of Australia, will present to you tonight the Ypsilantis family, the Black Sea, Hellenes, and the War of Independence. The National Committee has coordinated a program of events in each state and territory of Australia, a program which commenced in September 2020 and will continue throughout this year. I would like to begin by acknowledging the Gadigal people, traditional custodians of the land on which we gather today, and pay my respects to the elders both past and present. I extend that respect to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples here this evening. With us this evening, we have our very Reverend Father Christophoros Grigelis, Greek Consulate General of Sydney, Christos Karas, Vasilis Adratas, Secretary of the National Committee of the Archdiocese of Australia, 200th anniversary of the Greek Revolution. We have with us Peter Stefanidis, President of the Federation of Pontian Associations of Australia, Maria Anthony, President of Pontus New South Wales, Peter Papoulidis, President of Panagia Sumela, New South Wales, Nick Christosomidis, President of the Oyenis Wollongong, and Liana Vedzialias, President of the Hellenic Lyceum Sydney. We would like to begin tonight's event by inviting Father Christophoros to open with a blessing.
Καθίστε. Καλησπέρα σας, αγαπητέ κύριε Γενικέ, εκπρόσωποι από τα διάφορα σωματεία των ποντίων εδώ της Νέας Νότιας Ιουαλίας, αγαπητέ κύριε Στεφανίδη, πρόεδρε της Ομοσπονδίας Ποντιακών Σωματείων Αυστραλίας, αγαπητά παιδιά μας, με μεγάλη χαρά εκπροσωπεύω απόψε τον Σεβασμιότατο που ο ίδιος στέλνει τις ευχές του και την αγάπη του από το φανάρι. Και εντυπωσιακό είναι διότι γνωρίζουμε ότι και η οικογένεια Ypsilantis ήταν και αυτοί οι φαναριώτες. Και τι ωραίο να έρχονται οι ευχές από αυτή την πόλη που ακόμα έχει φως και φωτίζει και μας εδώ στην μακρινή Αυστραλία. Πιστεύω ότι από αυτά που θα ακούσουμε απόψε θα συγκινηθούμε, αλλά σκεφτώντας κάποια πράγματα τώρα που κατέβηκα κάτω, αυτό που κάνει εντύπωση σε μένα προσωπικά είναι ότι αυτή η οικογένεια ήταν σαν εμάς. Πρώτον Έλληνες του εξωτερικού. Δεύτερον, με κάνει εντύπωση διότι εχθές το βράδυ τυχαία έβλεπα ένα ντοκιουμεντέρ για το Αϊβαλί και μια οικογένεια, μια κοπέλα βέβαια σε αυτό, έδειξε ένα μικρό κομμάτι, tag που λέμε εμείς στα αγγλικά, με αριθμό που φόραγε ο πατέρας της όταν φτάσανε στην Ελλάδα. Και γιατί αναφέρομαι σε αυτό? Πολύ απλά, κάποιοι εδώ θα γνωρίζετε πολύ πιο καλά από εμένα, ότι όταν φτάσανε και οι δικοί μας στην μητέρα Ελλάδα, δεν τους δέχτηκε η μητέρα Ελλάδα έτσι πως πιστεύανε θα τους δεχτεί. Αλλά και για αυτούς βέβαια εκεί σήμερα είναι ίσως κάτι που τους ταπεινώνει, ίσως κάτι και για αυτούς να θυμηθούν ότι και εμείς ήμασταν Έλληνες και εμείς προσφέραμε πρόσωπα σαν τον Ypsilantis στον αγώνα αυτό για μια ελεύθερη Ελλάδα. Ευχόμεθα στα παιδιά βέβαια πιο πολύ που είναι εδώ να μην ξεχάσουν αυτή την ιστορία για να κρατούν το λάβαρο και τη σημαία μας ψηλά, όχι μόνο για 200 χρόνια ακόμα, αλλά για πολλά χρόνια ακόμα. Καλό σας βράδυ και τις ευχές βέβαια του Σεβασμιωτάτου.
Thank you, Your Grace, for your very special words. We would like to invite Consul General Mr. Christos Karas to say a few words.
Πάτερ Χριστοφόρε, πρόεδρε και μέλη των Ποντιακών Σωματείων της Νότιας Ουαλίας, του Ποντοξενιτέα, της Παναγίας Ομελά και του Διογένης Γούλανγκογκ, όπως και της Ομοσπονδίας Ποντιακών Ενώσεων Αυστραλίας, Δόκτωρ Παναγιώτη Διαμάτης και Δόκτωρ Ατραχτάς, Βασιλεία Ατραχτάς, αξιότιμοι προσκεκλημένοι, αγαπητοί φίλοι, είναι μεγάλη χαρά και τιμή μου που παρευρίσκομαι στη σημερινή εκδήλωση, στη σημερινή διάλεξη με τίτλο «Η οικογένεια Ypsilantis, οι Έλληνες της Μαύρης Θάλασσας και ο αγώνας της Ανεξαρτησίας», που είναι τμήμα του προγράμματος της Εθνικής Επιτροπής της Ελληνικής Ορθόδοξης Αρχιεπισκοπής για τα 200 χρόνια από την έναρξη της Ελληνικής Επανάστασης. Η Ελληνική Επανάσταση εμπνεύστηκε από τις ιδέες του Ευρωπαϊκού Διαφωτισμού και από την Αμερικανική και την Γαλλική Επανάσταση, από τα ιδανικά της ελευθερίας, της αξιοπρέπειας, της δικαιοσύνης και της δημοκρατίας. Και η επιτυχής έκβασή της ήταν οφειλόταν σε μεγάλο βαθμό στην υποστήριξη που άντλησε από την μεγάλη ελληνική διασπορά. Οι Έλληνες της Διασποράς πάσχισαν να προωθήσουν τον ελληνικό αγώνα, την ελληνική υπόθεση, και ήταν το δικό τους έργο που αποδείχτηκε κρίσιμο για το μέλλον της Ελληνικής Επανάστασης. Θυμίζω, παραδείγματος χάρη, ότι μετά το τέλος των δύο ρωσοτουρκικών πολέμων του δεύτερου ημίσιος του 18ου αιώνα, πολλοί Έλληνες, κυρίως από την Πελοπόννησο και τα νησιά του Αιγαίου, κατευθύνθηκαν προς την Νότια Ρωσία και την Χερσόνησο της Κρυμαίας, όπου ίδρυσαν αξιοσημείωτες παροικίες, με κορυφαία ίσως την παροικία της Οδυσσού. Οι συνθήκες για την ελληνική διασπορά ήταν επίσης ευνοϊκές και στις δύο παραδουνάβιες ηγεμονίες, στη Βλαχία και στην Μολδαβία, λόγω της προστασίας που απολάμβαναν εκεί από την φαναριώτικη τάξη που ηγεμόνευε σε αυτές τις περιοχές από το 1711. Ήταν ακριβώς στην Οδυσσό, όπου τρεις Έλληνες έμποροι, ο Νικόλαος Κουφάς, ο Εμμανουήλ Ξάνθος και ο Αθανάσιος Τσεκάλοφ, εμπνεώμενοι από το παράδειγμα και το μαρτυρικό θάνατο του Ρίγα Φεραίου, ίδρυσαν την μυστική φιλική εταιρεία το 1814, η οποία συντόνισε την έναρξη της Ελληνικής Επανάστασης κατά της Οθωμανικής Αυτοκρατορίας. Ήταν ο Αλέξανδρος Ypsilantis, μέλος μιας επιφανούς οικογένειας φαναριωτών και πρίγκιπας των παραδουνάβιων ηγεμονιών, και ο ηγέτης της φιλικής εταιρείας από τον Απρίλιο του 1814, ο οποίος στις 22 Φεβρουαρίου του 1820 διέβη τον ποταμό Προύθο με τους υποστηρικτές του, και δύο μέρες αργότερα στο Ιάσιο εξέδωσε την περίφημη προκήρυξη μάχου υπερπίστεως και πατρίδος, καλώντας όλους τους Έλληνες και τους χριστιανούς να εξεγερθούν κατά των Οθωμανών. Ήταν ο αδερφός του Αλέξανδρου, ο Νικόλαος Ypsilantis, αυτός που ηγήθηκε του Ιερού Λόχου στην μάχη του Δραγατσανίου, και ήταν ένας άλλος αδερφός του, ο Δημήτριος Ypsilantis, ο οποίος στις 12 Σεπτεμβρίου του 1829 οδήγησε νικηφόρα τον ελληνικό στρατό στη μάχη της Πέτρας, την τελευταία μάχη του ελληνικού αγώνα της Ανεξαρτησίας. Ο Δημήτριος Ypsilantis με αυτόν τον τρόπο είχε την τιμή να θέσει τέλος στον πόλεμο που ξεκίνησε ο αδερφός του Αλέξανδρος Ypsilantis, όταν διέβη το ποταμό Προύθο 8,5 χρόνια νωρίτερα. Ήθελα να συγχαρώ θερμά της Ποντιακής Ενώσης της Νέας Νότιας Ουαλίας, τον Ποντοξενιτέα, την Παναγία Σουμελά και τον Διογέννη Γούλαγκογκ, όπως και την Ποντιακή Ομοσπονδία της Αυστραλίας, για την διοργάνωση της σημερινής εκδήλωσης. Σας ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Thank you, Mr. Karras. Next, we have Aki Flame, who is a second-generation Greek-Australian with proud Pontian ancestry. He maintains strong connections to his culture and ancestry through a continuing use of language, cultural practices, and a commitment to the central tenets of Hellenism, namely education. Outside of pursuing classical, historical, and language education throughout his schooling years, he has continued on to study medicine, from which he will graduate from the University of Sydney this year. He will be presenting to us the biography of Alexandros Ypsilantis, the first leader of the War of Independence.
Alexander Ypsilantis was one of the most important revolutionaries in Hellenic history, and was instrumental to the formation of modern Greece. He was born in 1792 in Constantinople to a prominent Greek family hailing from Phanari, the chief Greek quarter of Constantinople, where the Ecumenical Patriarchy is located. Greeks from this area traditionally occupied important positions in the Ottoman Empire, and Ypsilantis' family was no different. In 1805, he fled with his family to Russia when war broke out between the Ottoman Empire and the Russian Empire. His father, of Pontian Greek ancestry, and his mother both belonged to members of this nobility in a region near the Black Sea, and thus he received an invitation to visit the court of the Tsar of Russia. In 1808, at the age of 16, he joined a Russian military mounted brigade. During this period, Tsar Alexander I entered into an alliance with several other European monarchs against France. A general named Napoleon had assumed power, and shortly after the French Revolution, the French army invaded Russia, and Ypsilantis served in the Tsar's military forces. He lost his right arm during the fighting, but despite this, at the young age of 25, he'd become a general. Meanwhile, the Napoleonic Wars from 1797 to 1814 had proven profitable for Greek Orthodox artisans, seamen, and merchants who'd settled in southeast Russia and the Danubian principalities. The continental blockade imposed by the British offered ample opportunities to courageous entrepreneurs. However, Napoleon's defeat put an end to these favourable circumstances and drove these groups into bankruptcy. And it was under these social and economic conditions that in 1814, in Odessa, three bankrupt merchants, Nikolaos Skoufas, Andreas Tsakalov, and Emmanuel Xanthos, founded the Filikieteria. Influenced by French revolutionary ideas, they decided to become more active in order to liberate their motherland from the Ottoman rule and to create a nation-state conforming to their aspirations. In 1820, Ypsilantis was approached by Manuel Xanthos, one of the leaders of the Filikieteria, and he agreed to join the secret society. Very soon, he was given the title of General Commissioner. In February 1821, Ypsilantis crossed the River Prut to Moldavia, thus raising the first signal for an uprising. Ypsilantis' proclamation, Fight for Faith and the Motherland, is considered as one of the fundamental documents of the Greek War of Independence. And without it, many historians might suggest, the subsequent revolution might never have taken place. He said, The time has come, O Hellenes. Our brothers and friends are everywhere ready. Let us join together then with enthusiasm. Our motherland is calling us.
Thank you, Aki, for providing that historical context. Also a second-generation Greek-Australian, Kosta Papoulidis will be presenting his biography on Dimitrios Ypsilantis. Kosta shares great commitment to learning and teaching about his Greek and Pontian heritage through his position as an early education Greek school teacher with St. Nectarios Church. His passion for teaching is pursued through his Bachelor of Secondary Education and a Bachelor of Arts at the Australian Catholic University, majoring in Modern Greek at Macquarie University. Welcome, Kosta.
Dimitrios Ypsilantis was born in 1793 138 years after his family left Trapezunda, their native homeland in Pondo, into the very influential Ypsilanti Greek family based in Constantinople. In his early life, he was sent to France, where he was educated at a military school, as most military hopefuls were those days. He later joined the Imperial Russian Army, thanks to his family's Russian ties, of course, under Tsar Alexander I, and distinguished himself in the Russian campaign of 1814, fighting a very little-known historical figure. Don't know if you guys have heard of him. Napoleon Bonaparte. This is where he first proved his worth as a military commander, successfully keeping the Russian army at a strategic advantage over Napoleon's retreating French army. Dimitrios later joined his brother Alexandros, by then the leader of the Feliki Eteria, in the Wallachian uprising of 1821, the prelude to the Greek War of Independence. Following the breakout of the Greek War of Independence, however, Dimitrios was sent to Peloponnesus as a representative of the Eteria and his brother Alexandros. One of his first major battles was a siege of Tripolitsa, won way earlier than expected by the Greek generals thanks to Ypsilantis' contribution. Dimitrios also took place in the Battle of Nafplion, the defense of the future capital against Ibrahim Pasha of Egypt. The invader was defeated at the Battle of Lerna Mills by a force of only 400 Greeks against Ibrahim's 5,000. The lead admiral, Andreas Miaoulis, based his strategy on the Battle of Salamis, whose 2,500th year anniversary was last year, by the way. I digress. Dimitrios played a very key part during the expedition of Mahmud Dramali Pasha, who amassed an Ottoman army of 12,000 men and 8,000 cavalry, the largest Ottoman force seen in mainland Greece since the Ottoman-Venetian War about 100 years prior. Ypsilanti, along with his fellow commanders, including Kolokotroni, Papaflessa, and Nikitaras, successfully repelled this Ottoman army using a military force less than half the size of their opponents. This resulted in the almost complete destruction of the Ottoman forces, with 17,000 casualties on their side. A major win for the Greek War of Independence. In 1828, Dimitrios Ypsilantis was appointed General of the Greek Army in Eastern Greece, in the newly established regular Hellenic army by Ioannis Kapodistrias, the first governor of the modern Greek state. Dimitrios mobilized the Hellenic army into a formal modern European army rather than a force of guerrilla bands in the preparation for the Battle of Petra, which Mr. Karas pointed earlier was the last battle of the Greek War of Independence. After a hail of gunfire, the Greeks charged, swords drawn, and drove the Ottoman army into a very disorderly retreat. The rest of the Ottoman army, now in danger of being surrounded, also retreated. The Ottoman army was unable to advance and as a result concluded a capitulation on the 25th of September 1829. Thus ending the active operations for the Greek War of Independence. Dimitrios Ypsilantis sadly died due to an illness in Nafplion in Greece, on August 16th, 1832. Thank you.
Thank you, Costa, for your contribution. It's great to see our youth being involved in these important events, taking initiative to research into our Hellenic history, keeping our culture alive in the next generation. Thank you to Aki and Costa for your efforts. Next, we have Dr. Panayotis Diamandis, who is a historian and genocide scholar, born and educated in Sydney. An experienced researcher and public speaker, Dr. Diamandis has served the Australian Pontian Association since the 1980s. Using the Ypsilanti family as illustrative examples, Dr. Diamandis will elaborate on how the region around the Black Sea, known as Pontus, was the birthplace of the Hellenic War of Independence and the First Hellenic Republic. A key point to take away from this evening is the role of the Hellenic diaspora, the Hellenic communities outside the homeland played and continues to play in the development of the Hellenic state.
Τώρα θα παίξει και ρόλο και η τεχνολογία, έτσι. Γιατί αυτός, με αφορμή αυτόν τον Κύριο, μαζευτήκαμε εδώ απόψε και τιμούμε τόσο τον πρόσωπό του, όσο και τους προγόνους, όσο και την επέτειο της σημερινή. Πατέρα Χριστοφόρε, κύριε Καρά, κύριε Γενικέ, κυρίες και κύριοι, αδέλφια συνέλληνες, καλώς ήρθατε, ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ την τιμή που μου κάνει τόσο η Ομοσπονδία, τα Ποντιακά Σωματεία του Σίδνεϊ, του Wollongong, όσο και η Θεολογική Σχολή εδώ, η δική μας, του Αποστόλου Ανδρέα, της Αρχιεπισκοπής μας, που μου δώσουν την ευκαιρία να μιλήσω απόψε για αυτό το θέμα. Όπως πάντα, για αυτούς που με γνωρίζουν, το παίζω δίγλωσσο, χωρίς να πω και τώρα κάποια λόγια στα ελληνικά, απλώς θα αλλάξω γλώσσα και μπρος και πίσω. Και όσο γίνεται, στην οθόνη θα έχω και, και κάποιες σημειώσεις για να βοηθήσω αυτούς που έχουν δυσκολία με την μία γλώσσα ή με την άλλη. Όπως πολύ σωστά είπε και η πολύ ωραία ιταλιτάρχης μας που τα κάνει μια χαρά μέχρι τώρα και με το καλό να τα ολοκληρώσει απόψε, έχω τρία πράγματα που θέλω να πάρτε μαζί σας όταν τελειώσει η απόψινή βραδιά. Όλοι γνωρίζουμε για την Αγία Λαύρα, όλοι γνωρίζουμε για την 25η Μαρτίου, η εθνική μας γιορτή. Λίγοι γνωρίζουν ότι ο αγώνας, ο πόλεμος για την ανεξαρτησία του ελληνισμού ξεκίνησε σαν σήμερα ακριβώς. Γι' αυτό διαλέξαμε την 24η Φεβρουαρίου για να κάνουμε την εκδήλωση αυτή. Σήμερα είναι ακριβώς 200 χρόνια από την κήρυξη του εθνικού αγώνα, από την προκήρυξη του Αλεξάνδρου Ypsilanti. Exactly 200 years ago, today. And this is why we chose today. Εύξηνος Πόντος, not just the strip of land which you know most of your ancestors are from, but the broader Πόντος Basin, all the lands around the Black Sea, the Εύξηνος Πόντος. This was the true birthplace of the War of Independence, of the Hellenic Independence Movement. And I'll explain, as I go through, I'll explain in greater detail. The first war, the first battles, as we heard from Aki and from Costa and from Kyrios Karas and others, were in lands not far from the coast of the Black Sea, in what is today Romania, back then Moldovlahia. Never forget, and this is probably the most important point, and I'm glad, Pater, you elaborated on this in your welcome speech, the role of the diaspora. The communities outside Greece is where the independence movement began. It did not begin in what we call Greece. It began in Constantinople, it began in Smyrna, it began in Odysseus. They are the ones who organized, they are the ones who, κακά τα ψέματα, χωρίς το ψηλό, δεν γίνεται τίποτα. They're the ones who put the money down to buy the weapons to fight the war. In some cases, like Mandob Mavrogenos, you saw her portrait on the slideshow beforehand, lost everything. She gave every cent she had to the independence war. The Ypsilantis brothers, both died in poverty. They gave everything that they had. None of these were born in what we call Greece. Mandou Mavrogenos I keep asking people this, and hardly anybody knows the answer. She was born in a city called Trieste, Trieste. Today it's on the border of Italy and Croatia. But her family was from Mykonos. She's like us. The family left for economic reasons, political reasons, whatever it was. They left their choria, their islands, migrated somewhere else. Back in the day, the favourite places were Italy, what we now call Ukraine and Russia, and Egypt. These were the places to go because this is where you could make a living. This is where you can make very good money very quickly. And these are the people who funded the War of Independence. We'll stick to Ypsilantis Pontus, even though we could talk about Egypt and Italy and everywhere else. Should we turn the lights off or leave them on? It's better to leave them on for the filming? Asked. My apologies. Ελπίζω να ακούγουμε πίσω, έτσι. Άκη, Δημήτρη, yep, ακούγουμε μια χαρά. Okay. Here we have a map of the Black Sea without borders, not political borders. Each one of the dots was an ancient Greek colony, but also in the time we're talking about, the 1800s, a major Greek community was there, particularly wealthy ones. Of course, Constantinople, η Βασιλεύουσα, the queen of cities. And I love mentioning this in class, that when Frankfurt was a two-goat town, London had mud streets, these guys had street lighting, paving and guttering, not to mention the sewage system. The only city outside China with more than 1 million people. Vatoumi, there are some people probably whose families are from Vatoumi, or to use its ancient Greek name, Vathis Limin. That's where the Georgians got Vatoumi from, Batum today. Samsunda, Sinope, and the most important ones for our story, Odysseus, up in the top corner, Odessa. Those of you into World War II might have heard of a book called The Odessa Files, really good thriller spy novel, Nazis and all that sort of stuff. Well, this is Odessa. This is the birthplace of the revolution. This city, three men, and we've heard their names before, two of them Epirotes, of course, we have to mention this. This may be a Pondian event, but under Benepsis to Spiti Sou, Tapes and Seplakosi. Businessmen, if your phones are still on, please turn them off. Businessmen sat down around a coffee table. Coffee room in the early 1800s, coffee was a new invention, that's it. It had only been around for about 100 years. And the Viennese, parenthesis, the Viennese, to celebrate their great victory over the Turks at the siege of Vienna, what did they invent? A new pastry called le croissant. Why is it that shape? To miso fengaro. That's what croissant means. It means crescent. It was invented to go with coffee, which they picked up from the Turks, but they don't like talking about that. Who picked it up from the Arabs? Who picked it up from the Ethiopians? And of course, we perfected it. Rigas Fereos. We heard his name mentioned before, 1797. From a town called Velestino in Thessaly, in the better half of Greece. And was writing. He was an intellectual. Where was he writing? Austria, Hungary, Italy. Not in what we call Greece. And I regularly have this debate with my Pondian friends. You guys only became Pondian in the 1920s. And they go, what are you talking about? We've always been Pondian. We've been Pondian for 3,000 years. I go, rubbish. The name Pondian is only about 100 years old. In this time, ήταν Μαυροθαλασσίτες, the Black Sea people, the people of the Black Sea, around the Black Sea. Or to use the name that is still used for the people of that area who still live there, Karadenizli, the Black Sea people, the Black Sea ones. In his writings, Phaereos talks about Mavrothalassini. Ο βάρβαρος ως πότε θε να σας τυραννεί. He's talking to the Pontians. But they would not have understood the name Pontian. It had no meaning for them. But even and the next paragraph, I deliberately, for space, I didn't put it in. The next paragraph talks about the Macedonians. And he goes on. But the guy was from Thessaly. And I mention this on purpose. Their concept of what constitutes Greece or the Hellenic world is way broader than what we understand it. Their concept of Greece was not the borders of the state that we know today. It was way bigger than this. Basically, it covered all of southeastern Europe and most of Anatolia. That's what they understood of as Greece. Costa, in his address, mentioned that they were from Trapezunda. I'll take you one generation back. They were actually from the town, from the Luchorio called Ypsil, or Ypsili. And it's right down, I don't have my pointer, where it's got the .gr, it's right at the top of the R of the .gr. It's right up in the Pontian Mountains. It's about 2,000 metres altitude. Τώρα είναι κάτι παρχάρια, δεν έχει μείνει και πολλοί κόσμος εκεί πάνω. But that is the ancestral town, the ancestral place of the Ypsilantis family. And they became this great Φαναριώτη family over 200 years. In 200 years, we'll probably be talking about the same way about a number of Greek-Australian families. Think about the ones that have been here 100 years already. The Paspali family. Girls, you know, Paspali pearls. From Megisti, from Castellorizo. The Kailis family, again in Western Australia. The Macris family over in Adelaide. And we could rattle them off. Give them another 100 years. They'll be completely Australian. But they'll still have this connection. And the most famous one of these families in the world, the Bulgari family. Most of you would have heard the jewellery brand Bulgari, Epirotes, again. Η εταιρεία των φιλικών. It actually gets under my skin when people say φιλική εταιρεία. It's η εταιρεία των φιλικών. The Society of Friends. It was a secret society. You were sworn in. You took an oath to keep your secrecy. Why? What was the big deal? You're only planning the dismantling of an empire. So if the imperial government finds out, they're going to kind of like tear you limb from limb until you spill your guts, and then literally spill your guts. So secrecy was really important. Το αυτό είναι κέρινα ομοιώματα από το Μουσείο Βρέλη στα Γιάννενα. Τα έκανε ο Μακαρίτης πλέον, ο Παύλος Βρέλης. Και εδώ από δεξιά είναι εκεί που έγινε η ίδρυση της εταιρείας των φιλικών στην Οδυσσό. Είναι πλέον ελληνικό μουσείο. Το διατηρεί η κυβέρνηση της Ουκρανίας. Δεν έχω πάει ποτέ. Προλάβατε να πάτε? Όχι. One of Mr. Garas's previous posts was in Moscow, so I thought maybe you could have popped down. It's only 2,000 kilometres away. Well, you've been to Perth, and that's 2,000 kilometres away. So it's a museum. You can actually visit it. You can actually see the rooms where the Eteria was formed. And it was formed around a coffee table. So Friday nights or Sundays over at Panagiasomela, Friday nights at Pontoxeniteas, when they're sitting around playing their cards, this is how the Eteria των Φιλικών started. This is how the whole revolution started, by people simply talking around a coffee table. Or if it was winter, some vodka. Πότε πάρθηκε η απόφαση για την Επανάσταση? Η ημέρα ήταν 7 Οκτωβρίου του 1820. This is the day that the Εταιρεία των Φιλικών, the leadership, Ypsilantis, and everybody around him, decided to commence what they called the Sjedion Yenikon, the general operation. And what was day X or D-Day? The 25th of March, 1821. So why did the revolution start a month before? Why did it start on the 24th of February? Because someone betrayed them. One of the members of the Eteria spilled his guts, told his secrets, for whatever reason. So all the preparations had to be accelerated by a month. And that's how we ended up with the actual fighting starting on the 24th, but the day specified being the 25th. Now that's rather interesting. But these guys were planning for years earlier. Planning what? Not just Agia Lavra, not just Peloponneso, not just Kapia Nisia. They wanted to hit the Ottoman Empire on multiple fronts at once. Θα τα βάλουμε εμείς μια χούφτα ανθρώπι, μια χούφτα αντάρτες, θα τα βάλουμε με ολόκληρη αυτοκρατορία. Πώς θα γίνει αυτό? Μόνο ένας τρόπος είναι. Πρέπει να τους χτυπήσουμε σε πολλά σημεία ταυτόχρονα. I think it was Aki who talked about that the friends are with our brothers and our friends are with us. You mentioned the extract from Ypsilantis' speech, from his declaration. The friends they're talking about were the Russians, the Serbs, the Montenegrins. Why were they friends? What did they share? Faith. It was more than the commercial, just the business connections, the business ties. It was more than the family ties. It was the fact that they were all Orthodox. Even in Ypsilantis' declaration himself, doesn't say country and faith or country and church. Υπερπίστεως και πατρίδος. The faith comes first. No, don't underestimate this. The revolution was started primarily not as a political movement, but a religious one. Okay. Όπως είδαμε και πρωτού, η περίφημη αυτή σκηνή περνάει τον ποταμό, περνάει από την Ρωσική Αυτοκρατορία και περνάει απέναντι στην Οθωμανική Αυτοκρατορία, στο Ιάσιο. Yash. Today the city is called Yash in the northeastern part of Romania. Mahu Iperpisteos ke Patridos, as I just mentioned. This was the title of his declaration. His declaration of independence. You know, the Americans have that document, the Declaration of Independence. This is the Greek one. Amongst other things, so you actually find the whole text in Greek on the web. Or just email me, I'll pass it on to you. But amongst other things, η ώρα ήλθεν ο Έλληνες. The time has come. Why? Because we now believe we are now ready. Εις τα όπλα λοιπόν φίλοι, and this is why they're called φιλικοί, Society of Friends, η εταιρεία των φιλικών, η πατρίς μας προσκαλεί. As we heard before, their point, their plan, was to create a Hellenic nation state. Now don't underestimate how radical an idea this was. What was the Ottoman Empire? Multi-ethnic, multi-religious, ruled by the Muslim Turkish-speaking dynasty, but multi-ethnic, multi-religious. You want to see how multi-ethnic? Just take a look at the portraits of all the Ottoman sultans from the beginning to the 1900s, to the last one in 1920. And the closer you get to 1900s, the more European they look. Why is that? Because most of their mums were Europeans. So the Asian look disappears over time. By the time you get to the 1700s, it's basically gone. April 1820. Ypsilantis becomes leadership, but given the leadership, why? Why did they pick this guy? Επειδή ήταν φαναριώτης, επειδή ήταν από πλούσια οικογένεια, από μεγάλη οικογένεια, γιατί τον διάλεξαν, τι είχε, γιατί στολή φοράει, εδώ, στην ελαιογραφία. Στρατιωτική, ρωσική. He was a military man. Πάμε για πόλεμο. Καλή χρυσή η δασκάλη, αλλά δεν θα βάλεις δάσκαλο μπροστά να σε πάει στο, να διευθύνει την μάχη. Θα βάλεις στρατηγό. Και μάλιστα ένα στρατηγό που αναγνωρίζεται και από άλλους. Από άλλη χώρα. Εδώ βλέπουμε στο χάρτη από πίσω βλέπετε που, ήταν ο ποταμός, που είναι ο ποταμός και χωρίζει την Αυστρία από την Οθωμανική Αυτοκρατορία. Τι λάβαρο κρατούσε, τι σημαία είχε, τη γαλανόλευκη, τι είχε. That is the first Greek flag. The Harry Potter fans will understand the inscription. Well, they should anyway. Those of you who can read Greek. Εκ της κόνεώς μου αναγεννώμαι. From my ashes I am reborn. Phoenix. Harry Potter is a great series, but it's a total rip-off of our mythology and our history. Why the red, the white, and the black? Who was he not... Basically, who was he sucking up to when he picked these particular colours? Anybody know which empire at the time in the early 1800s had these colours as its flag? It wasn't the Russians, it was the Austrians. He's sucking up to the next door. Think about it. You need friends. You're not going to win this war by yourself. You need allies. You need people with money, and you need people with guns. And you need people with a grudge. You think the Austrians forgot the siege of Vienna? Both of them. They were looking to expand into southern Europe, into the Balkans. So he picked this particular design. The phoenix, though, is a very ancient Greek symbol of rebirth, of renewal. 1453 was not the end of the free Greek states. 1461 was. Το τελευταίο ελεύθερο ελληνικό κράτος έπεσε όχι το 1453 με την άλωση της πόλεως, αλλά 15 Αύγουστος του 1461, όταν έπεσε η Τραπεζούντα. So out of those ashes, we reborn. We are reborn. Ξαναγεννιέται το ελληνικό κράτος. Όχι το ελλαδικό, το ελληνικό. They were called Μαυροθαλασσίτες. There were even units, military units, in the sacred band, the group that fought in Moldovlachia, in Romania. Fought in Peloponnesus, fought in Stereo Ellada. Of men who came from the Black Sea, from what we call Pontus. They're generally listed as Mavrothalassites. Sometimes, one particular group I can think of, Ikromnei, from the group of villages around Kromni in the highlands. One of the most famous ones was Alexis Mavrothalassites. Obviously, it's a nickname. Ήταν αυτό που το λέγουμε σήμερα, Pontius. He was there in 1821. The revolution did not only happen in Peloponnesus or in the islands or in Epiro or in Macedonia. 1821, we had fighting in Pontus, savage fighting. We had Pontians fighting in Idra. Sailors, think about it. What is the easiest way, εσείς που έχετε πάει στον Πόντο, Τάκη, πώς είναι ο πιο εύκολος τρόπος τότε, πριν γίνουν οι αυτοκινητόδρομοι, να πας από Τραπεζούντα στα Σούρμενα ή στην Όφη ή οποιαδήποτε πόλη. Το πιο εύκολο ήταν με το καράβι. Αυτοί που ζούσαν στα παράλια έγιναν πάρα πολύ καλοί ναυτικοί. και αρκετοί πόντοι, αυτό που λέμε μαυροθαλασσίτες πόντοι, υπηρέτησαν στον στόλο της ύδρας, των σπετσών, των ψαρών, της Σάμου. Ακόμα και στην Κρήτη είχαμε τουλάχιστον 120 μαυροθαλασσίτες, οι οποίοι πολέμησαν το 21 με 29. Και είναι πράγματα τα οποία τα ξεχνάμε. Στην Πέτρα, ο Δημήτριος Ypsilantis, το έχουμε αναφέρει. Ο Ιερός Λόχος, the group that actually launched the revolution in Romania under Alexandros Ypsilantis, was declared to be a guerrilla force of Μαυροθαλασσίτες by the Sultan's government. It's a conspiracy by the Pontians. Sounds funny, but he was being quite serious. Anybody associated with it was sentenced to death straight away. Ever wondered why so few families, why most of your families are from Eastern Pontus, not Western Pontus, like Paphra? Because particularly in the 1800s, they were systematically slaughtered. There's one village near my village, the closest Pontian village to my own, is called Paphra. Paphra και Νεοκεσάρια είναι δίπλα, in the campus in Γιάννενα. There's not many. Because they were good fighters, they had to be dealt with, had to be gotten rid of. I will wrap up, because I've gone over time. Πώς σκεφτόντουσαν αυτοί για τον Ελληνισμό? Τι σημαίνει Ελλάς για αυτούς? This is, as I said at the beginning, this is probably the most important thing I want you to take away from tonight. Greece, Ελλάς, was not just this little box. It went from the southern part of Italy to the Caucasus Mountains. This is what they understood of as Ελλάς. Now, I could show you a whole bunch of words and rattle off a whole list of writings about it, but the most important document for me is this one. Some of you will recognize it. Είναι η χάρτα του Ρίγα Φεραίου. This is 1790s. What is it a map of? Anybody seen it before? It's a map of Greece. Ielas. Where are the borders? Right up in what we now call the Danube River. All of the southeastern Europe was supposed to be part of one Greek-led state. A federation. Let's call it a federation. You'll notice it's not exactly to scale, but you'll notice Mikrasia's in there, η Κωνσταντινούπολη, η Κύπρος προς τα κάτω, η Κρήτη. What's that triangle like a pita, like a tropita shaped island? That's Sicily. For them, Sicily was part of the Greek world. Calabria, Apulia, the southern part of Italy, was part of the Greek world. What you don't know is that that is only one part of 12, a 12-part map. Where is it? There I got it. No, I want to talk about, I'll talk about the map in a minute. All right, this is the actual caption. What is Greece? What is Hellas? It is in Europe, and it is in Asia Minor, Anatolia. The girls and the guys that were dressed here, how many of you noticed that all of them have something with a double-headed eagle on it? Why? The double-headed eagle, because the Romans had their symbol as the eagle. Μένα κεφάλι. Why does the Greek, the medieval one, have two heads? Because it looks two directions, east and west. Why does the Pontian one only look west? What's it facing? Κωνσταντινούπολη. Το φανάρι, το φως. All right, up to the Danube, the Sava River in Serbia, the Carpathian Mountains, all this is part of, are going to be part of our state. And I did say Greek-led.
That's it.
Not a Greek state, a Greek-led state. Serbs, Bulgarians, Romanians, all these different peoples, you're all going to learn, you're all going to adopt a language. We already share a religion. We're all Orthodox. And through that, you're all going to adopt the Greek language. Through education, not through war, is how that they're going to create this big federation, but needed to get rid of the Ottoman Empire first. And here you can see, this is different parts of Rigas's, this is the complete of Rigas's map. It's literally the size of a wall, the full one. And this is what, this is, as I said, this is probably the most important thing I want you to take away from tonight. Η ευρύτερη περιοχή, η λεκάνη του Ευξήνου Πόντου, ήταν η κοιτίδα της Επαναστάσεως. Ήταν η κοιτίδα, η γενέτειρα του κινήματος της εθνικής παλιγενεσίας. Η διασπορά, αυτοί που ζούσαν εκτός πατρίδος, που ήταν απόδημοι, ήταν έξω από τον Δήμο, από το σπίτι τους. Από εκεί ξεκίνησαν. Αυτοί την έσωσαν, την χώρα. Και μετά, και πριν, και τότε, και μετά. Και πάλι, και πάλι, και πάλι. Το 12-13, πριν από μερικές ημέρες, γιορτάσαμε την απελευθέρωση των Ιωνίνων, στις 21 του Φλεβάρι. Πώς έγινε, πώς απελευθερώθηκε η Μυτιλίνη, η Λίμνος, όλα τα νησιά, η Μακεδονία, η... λίγο αργότερα η Θράκη. Πώς? Γιατί κάποιος της διασποράς πλήρωσε να αγοράσουμε κάτι που δεν είχαν οι Τούρκοι. Για ποιο πράγμα μιλάω? Το Αβέροφ. Αβέροφ δεν ήταν το πραγματικό του όνομα της οικογένειας. Έγινε Αβέροφ όταν πήγε πού? Αυτός πήγε Αίγυπτο, αλλά κάποιοι είχαν πάει πρωτού στη Ρωσία και το έκανε ρωσικό. They assimilated, but they kept who they were. This is, I believe, to this year's anniversary is not just an opportunity to commemorate the past, but also to look to the future. What are we doing in the next 200 years? We won't be here in 200 years. None of us will be here in 100 years. But what are we doing to continue Hellenism here in Australia? What are we doing to continue Hellenism στην πατρίδα, στην Ελλάς? Oh, for you guys, η πατρίδα στον Πόντο. That's what I believe is the point, ultimately, of these events. It's not just for you to sit there for half an hour and listen to people like me and show a few slides. The real point is, what are we doing next? Σε λίγο θα υπάρχει και ψήφος αποδήμων, κάποιων αποδήμων, στην Ελλάδα. Εμείς τι κάνουμε, πέρα από τον τουρισμό που κάνουμε, τι κάνουμε για την ανάπτυξη των σχέσεων Αυστραλίας-Ελλάδος? Πιστεύω ότι το 2021 είναι μια τεράστια ευκαιρία για να αναπτύξουμε αυτό το θέμα ακριβώς. Με την ηγεσία της Εθνικής Επιτροπής, της Ιεράς μας Αρχιεπισκοπής, με πρόεδρο φυσικά τον Σεβασμιότατο Αρχιεπίσκοπο Αυστραλίας, κύριο Μακάριο. Και αν κοιτάξετε το πρόγραμμα, το πλήρες πρόγραμμα, ακόμα και τις εκδηλώσεις, όλοι έχουν αυτό το χαρακτήρα. Πάρα πολλές εκδηλώσεις έχουν αυτό το χαρακτήρα. Το πώς θα συνδυάσουμε το Αυστραλιανό με το ελληνικό. How do we continue their struggle for Hellenism in the next 200 years? Not with weapons, but with words and ideas. Να είστε καλά. Ελπίζω να είναι η χοροδία έτοιμη.
Thank you, Dr. Diamandis, for your explanation on the Hellenic War of Independence and all your research. The Australia Hellenic Choir was established in 2018 to provide a valuable cultural resource to the community. In a short space of time, they've grown to over 50 members and sing a range of songs from Theodorakis, Hadzidakis, Plesas, and more. They are here with us this evening singing several classic songs from Theodorakis.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much for that performance. It was wonderful. Thank you. To offer a vote of thanks and his own message, I now invite the President of the Federation of Pontian Associations of Australia, Mr. Peter Stefanidis, who has travelled from Melbourne especially for this event.
Very simple message, very reverend Father Cristoforo, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Very quick message to you all. There is a saying the Pontians have, which I've come to really love and enjoy.
Της νέας νότιας δουλειάς ενωμένοι μαζί για να γιορτάζουμε αυτό το πολύ σημαντικό, αυτή τη πολύ σημαντική γιορτή, ειδικά την ημέρα που ξεσύσκωσε αυτός ο Πόντιος Ypsilantis τη σημαία της ελευθερίας μας. Και είναι η δική μου χαρά και τιμή που βρισκόμαστε όχι στην επιτροπή δικιά σας, αλλά στην επιτροπή δικιά μας. Μας κάνετε πάρα πολύ περήφανοι να ξέρετε ότι όταν μιλάω με τους πρόεδρους από την Γερμανία, από την Ελλάδα και ειδικά από την Αμερική, ακολουθάνε αυτά που κάνετε εδώ και ειδικά εδώ, σε αυτή την πολιτεία, σας δίνω ιδιαίτερα χαρά και να ξέρετε ότι είναι πάρα πολύ σημαντικό και αυτά που προσφέρετε ειδικά στην νεολαία σας, της νεολαίας μας. Θέλουμε και, άλλα και ανώτερα, θέλουμε να δούμε και τέτοια έργα και σας πω ιδιαίτερα εκ μέρους τα άτομα στο Διοικητικό Συμβούλιο μου, άτομα σαν τη Μαρία, άτομα σαν τον κύριο Παπολίδη, τον Νίκο, τον Χρήστο Στομίδη, οι αντιπρόσωποι σας, εκ μέρους όλοι μας, από γύρω της Ασσαλία, ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ για τη συμμετοχή σας, την προσπάθεια σας. Πάλι ευχαριστούμε πάλι την Εκκλησία μας, που χωρίς την Εκκλησία, όπως ξέρουμε, αυτή την ιδιότητα που έχουμε σήμερα δεν θα υπήρχε καθόλου. Αυτά ήθελα να πω. Πάλι συγχαρητήρια και καλώς σας βράδυ.
I'd like to thank Mr. Stefanidis for joining us this evening, especially following the recent lockdown of Victoria. The New South Wales Pontian Associations are very lucky to have you here tonight. We invite forward Father Christoforos to end tonight's event with a closing prayer.
In having the opportunity to address everyone in Greek earlier, I'll just take a moment to speak in English. Dearest Consul General of Greece, Mr. Christos Karas, your presence always is so needed here in the Antipodes, because your presence brings Greece in each room where you are. Dearest Presidents of the Pontian Associations of New South Wales, together with the President of the Federation, Mr. Peter Stefanidis, I take a moment to wish you all well and to convey the blessings of our Archbishop, who at present is in Constantinople. In saying that, I wish to thank on his behalf not only the youth that spoke, but our main guest speaker, Panagiotis Diamandis, because I'm sure we all leave with something that we didn't know, something which we didn't recognize before coming into this room. But in saying all of that, the most important thing for all of us, especially those of you that were born in Greece and came here, is for the younger generation which stands and is seated amongst us, that we give to them what we have, and for them to continue this element of our heritage so it is never erased from history's books. The only people that could possibly erase our existence, the only people that could possibly erase our contribution to the freedom which we know of, is us. So therefore, I ask very much so from our youth to maintain your heritage, to acknowledge all of the struggles of our ancestors, and to continue to be beacons and to be flags in some instances of both faith and heritage, of Greek heritage here in Australia. God bless you all. Again, I convey the blessings of His Eminence, who couldn't be here, but as I said earlier, it's quite a coincidence that He sends His blessings from the Whanaa, from where we know the Ypsilantis family lived, but also from where the beat of our heritage continues today. Thank you.
Thank you, Father, very much. On behalf of Pondoxeniteas, Panagia Soumela, Diogenes Wollongong, and the Federation of Pontian Associations of Australia, I take this opportunity to congratulate the National Committee for the celebration of the bicentenary of the War of Independence of the Greek Orthodox Archdiocese of Australia, under the leadership of His Eminence Archbishop Makarios of Australia, for the initiative in coordinating the program of almost 300 events across the year. All the best for the success of the program. A special thank you also to those who have dressed up for tonight's evening by wearing traditional costume. With us, we have Costa as an Evzone, Eleni in an Amalia, Ioana in a costume from the Epiros region, and Marios and Zoe in Pontian costumes. We thank the Hellenic Lyceum Sydney, Aristelian Academy and Pondoxeniteas Committee for allowing us to showcase their traditional costumes and remember our Hellenic past. Thank you to our distinguished guests, our youth, and to all of you for attending tonight's event. We will be serving refreshments, so please remain seated and we will serve to you in your seats. Thank you very much.